What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Imagine a film director orchestrating the creation of a cinematic masterpiece. Now, obviously, the director should have a team of specialized experts, such as screenwriters, cinematographers, special effects artists, and so on. However, this director doesn't want to oversee these roles, but insists on personally handling every aspect of the movie, from writing the script to managing the special effects, etc. This omnipotent director in the realm of software development is analogous to what we call a god class. A god class is a class that takes on excessive responsibilities, controlling numerous aspects of the system and breaching the principles of modular and maintainable code. This anti-pattern is found in designs where one class monopolizes the processing and other classes primarily encapsulate data. It is characterized by a class diagram composed of a single, complex class surrounded by simple data classes. The key problem here is that most of the responsibilities are allocated to a single class. Architectures with a god class separate the business logic from the data. In other words, they tend towards a procedural rather than object-oriented architecture. Okay, now that we know what a god class is, let's see how we can identify this anti-pattern. What are the symptoms we should be looking for? If the application contains a single class with 40 or more attributes and operations, then this indicates the presence of the god class. Other symptoms can be a collection of unrelated attributes and operations encapsulated in a single class, an absence of object-oriented design, marked by the presence of a single class nearly encapsulating the application's entire functionality, much like a procedural main program, a migrated legacy design that has not been properly refactored into an object-oriented architecture. Typical causes of this anti-pattern include a lack of object-oriented architecture and understanding, absence of defined system components and interactions, and inadequate architecture enforcement. Additionally, this anti-pattern may arise due to limited intervention in iterative projects, where developers incrementally add functionality to existing classes rather than introducing new ones. Having a god class in our application compromises the inherent advantages of an object-oriented design, such as limiting the ability to modify the system without affecting the functionality of other encapsulated objects. The god class is typically too complex for reuse and testing and may be expensive to load into memory as it uses excessive resources even for simple operations. But how can we solve this problem? If our application already contains a god class, how can we handle this architectural challenge and improve the overall design? You see, as with most anti-patterns, the solution involves some kind of refactoring. The key is to move behavior away from the god class. It may be appropriate to reallocate behavior to some of the encapsulated data objects in a way that makes these objects more capable. The method for refactoring responsibilities is as follows. The first step is to organize attributes and behaviors based on contracts, ensuring these contracts are cohesive and centered around a shared focus or function within the broader system. To do that, consider a retail management system architecture where we can pinpoint a potential god class named Store. In the diagram in front of us, the Store class encompasses the entirety of the system's functionalities. Consequently, our first task involves recognizing cohesive sets of operations and attributes that represent distinct contracts. For instance, we could group operations associated with inventory and stock management, like update stock and track stock. Furthermore, we might identify all operations and attributes linked to individual products, including display product, manage product, and so forth. The second step is to look for natural homes for this contract-based collection of functionalities and then migrate them there. In this example, we gather operations related to inventory and migrate them from the Store class to the Inventory class. We do the same with operations and attributes related to products and so on. This simplifies the Store class and elevates other classes beyond simple encapsulated data tables. The result is a better object-oriented design. The final step is to migrate derived classes to a common base class. In the example we have, we can argue that the inventory and the customers indeed belong to the store, but the products or items belong to the inventory as a first associative level. Now, sometimes, with a system composed of the god class and its supporting data objects, too much work needs to be invested to enable a refactoring of the class architecture. An alternative approach may be available that provides an 80% solution. Instead of a bottom-up refactoring of the entire class hierarchy, it may be possible to reduce this big class from a controller or manager on the whole business logic to a coordinator class. In a coordinator class, the original got class manages the system's functionalities, and the data classes are extended with some of their own functionalities which operate in the direction of the modified coordinator class. Finally, before ending the video, it goes without mentioning that it's much less expensive to create appropriate design than to rework design after implementation. Upfront investment in good architecture and team education can ensure a project against this and most other anti-patterns. Just as a director benefits from a collaborative and specialized film crew, a well-designed software system thrives when responsibilities are distributed among distinct classes, ensuring a more efficient and scalable codebase. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.